Hi friends, it's September 1st, 2015. I haven't posted in a while. It's been a very hot and brutal summer here in South Carolina. I've been buying packs of records here and there, of course. You can't stop that. That's just one of those things that I am going to do. But I bought a new turntable, which means that I'm going to sell an old turntable. And that old turntable has a special feature that I need to use before I can sell it. So I'll get right to that. So folks, what's the biggest record you've ever seen in your life? Okay, most of us are very familiar with the 12-inch LP. 12-inch diameter. This is our hi-fi. This was the de facto high-fidelity medium for, goodness, for the longest time on Earth. 12-inch record. And a lot of you may have seen a 10-inch 78. And a 10-inch 33. Or a 7-inch 45. Or also a 7-inch 33. Size does not necessarily equate to the speed, by the way. But, okay. This is a 12-inch record. This is a 16-inch record. Yes, folks. Back in the old days, radio programs were recorded in studios, cut onto disc, and the discs were sent out to the radio stations. And they played the records of that program. This is a radio transcription. It says lateral cut, 33 and a third RPM, start outside. Now some of these, you start from the outside and play from the, and it goes to the inside, progresses, and then when you flip it over, you start on the inside and it plays toward the outside. This one does not do that, though. This is not recorded in that way. They did that mainly because when you flip the sides and start it on the rim again, you'd notice a difference in the noise in the middle of the radio program. Okay, commercial timing and music on a tat sheet. Start outside. Use stylus pressure not in excess of 2 ounces. 2 ounces, folks. That is a tracking pressure of 56 grams. That's a heavy pressure. Well, they didn't expect these records to last long. They expected you to play them and send them back. Okay, this is a radio program. This also, I guess, was a radio program. This was for the Armed Forces Radio Service. Program time, 30 minutes. Now, I'm assuming that that means this is 15 minutes per side. So these, even though they're huge records, they really don't play very long. They're not an LP record. In fact, the groove pitch may be even the same as a 78. And I'm not sure if it requires a 3 mil point or not. I have chosen one that I am going to play for you. And that is this next one coming up. Excursions in Science. Program number 566. Program 567, the day and the date line. This side about insecticides, this about the day and the date line. They go a little bit, they start out on, you know, with their what they state they are. Then they go on to some little other little ersatz kind of things, like, you know, our reader in Poughkeepsie writes, but this has a little date stamped on July 5th, 1952. So I'm guessing this was after Independence Day on 1952. This one even says program time approximately 14 minutes 10 seconds on both sides. These also are lateral cut outside start. But that this is a radio program. This one here is not a radio program. This is copyright 1936. This is the soundtrack for a slideshow. In other words, you hear a beep and you change the slide. Beep, bing. Okay? This is a slideshow called For All Our Sakes, The Truth About Syphilis. Yeah, I guess, you know, and I played this, and it was, you know, back, you know, talking about venereal disease back in 1936 was pretty risque subject. They didn't want to talk about this stuff because they knew what it took to get it. So, 1936, this, and, you know, records are not limited to 16 inches either. Some Pathé discs go up to 20. Some of them even revolved at 90 RPM. Now, this one has a bit of a history. This one I am going to save for around Christmas time. This also was a radio program. This was a syndicated radio program, and I looked this one up. I have a date on this, actually, but I forgot what it is, so I can't tell you now. But this was Charles Dickens' A Christmas Carol, and it was Ronald Colman, the actor, the British actor, who was featured in this. So this is like from 1940 something or other. But anyway, this one, you know, it even has Frederick W. Ziv Company, who was a big big person in radio and television syndication and advertising and stuff like that. Publishing, I guess, I'm not sure. These also outside start, lateral cut, 33 and a third RPM. But anyway, these are 16-inch records. I'm going to play Insecticide for you, and I'm going to play the International Day and Dateline for you. I hope you like it. It's full of little scientific tidbits that you are never going to hear anymore anywhere. They don't teach this stuff in public schools anymore. So it could be enlightening for you. It could teach you some trivia that that you didn't expect. So anyway, on with the show. I hope you like it.
Do you know how the use of insecticides has resulted in more and more demand for the product? Do you know what part natural control still plays in the war against insects? Do you know whether a sundial always tells the right time, or why the beginning of each season does not always come on the same day each year? You may also want to know how far a ship can list and still right itself. Let's turn now to your science reporter, Howard Tupper, who has been talking to Dr. W.E. Dove, Director of Entomological Research for the U.S. Industrial Chemicals Company.
Dr. Dove was acquainting me with the situation in what he calls this new age of insecticides.
To be perfectly accurate, Tup, I think we ought to recognize that man has been battling insects in one way or another for countless centuries.
Yes, but we've come a long way from trying to smother insects with smoke or primitive smudge pots. For the most part, we are depending on chemicals as insecticides.
That's been going on for a number of years now, Tup. Do our insecticide needs seem to be reaching a stabilization point?
No, and it's hard to know when they will. First, and most obviously, we must remember that research in the field is going on constantly. As improvements are made, demand will mount. But an interesting additional point that Dr. Dove brought out is that the use of insecticides is directly responsible for an increased need.
Do you mean that you need more to do the job?
No, the job increases. The need is based on the volume of crops. But the volume of crops keeps increasing as insect damage is eliminated.
I never thought much about it in that way, but it surely couldn't have been too much of a surprise to those working in the insecticide field.
To some extent it was, though, Bill. Dr. Dove told me that the increased yields of crops suggest that insects were causing greater damage than previous estimates had indicated.
Has this widespread use of chemicals against insects made that the cheapest way of controlling them?
No, and Dr. Dove was very careful to emphasize that point. He said, first of all, that natural control is the cheapest method for control of pests. And in addition, he told me that because natural control plays a bigger role than most of us realize, one of the big problems is killing the insects without affecting their natural enemies.
Do you mean that some of the insects and also some of their enemies would be killed, but that the remaining insects would multiply faster than their enemies?
Exactly. Nature's biological balance would be upset.
Did Dr. Dove give you any examples of control by natural enemies?
Yes, a good many. I won't enumerate them right now, but I want to make sure I'm not giving you the wrong impression, Bill. Just as Dr. Dove wanted to emphasize the importance of natural control to guard against any idea of using chemicals exclusively, he also wanted to show the role that each must play.
In other words, make sure we're not interfering with the friendly parasites and predators, and then help them along with chemical insecticides.
Right.
Well, what are some of the other general precautions which have evolved?
Dr. Dove quoted Dr. Clausen of the University of California as feeling that insecticides of botanical origin are less likely than any others to be toxic to the insect's natural enemies. Rotenone, pyrethrum, and nicotine, to name a few, seem to kill only the adult parasites. The parasites emerging after the treatment are able to survive.
I'm all for being kind to the parasites which seem to be on our side, but what about precautions against materials which are toxic to human beings?
Dr. Dove said that a number of the newer insecticides, which are toxic to animals, can't be used around foods, feeds, food crops, food processing plants, or as direct animal sprays.
And that just about eliminates all possible applications.
Oh, no. They can still be used on fiber and other non-edible crops and in many other ways. Some of them can be used on fresh fruits and vegetables, but not within 60 days before the harvest.
Is there any way to be sure that such rules are being followed?
Yes. Dr. Dove said the Food and Drug Administration and the Meat Inspection Service of the Department of Agriculture are on the alert for any evidence of food contamination.
Well, Top, I want to thank you for this review of your discussion with Dr. W.E. Dove of U.S. Industrial Chemicals Company. Any of our listeners who would like a copy of Dr. Dove's paper on insecticides can have it merely by writing to Excursions in Science and asking for Science Paper 566. That same address is the one to use when sending along questions for us to answer. All of our listeners' questions will be referred to the General Electric Research Laboratory or some other authoritative organization. Each question will be answered by mail, and some with general interest will be discussed on future programs. Our first question comes from a listener who has heard that nothing is really solid. The explanation he has heard is that the nuclei and other parts of the atoms take up a very small amount of room, leaving mostly empty space between them.
That's true, but it's a little difficult to explain.
Well, our listener isn't asking for an explanation of that. He's just interested in knowing how something like lead can stop atomic radiations.
Well, it is true, as our listener suggests, that even solid matter is mostly empty space. However, the space between the electrons and nuclei that make up matter has strong electric, magnetic, and other field force properties. It is these electric and other fields that deflect or transform radiations. Since lead has very heavy atomic nuclei, it is more effective than lighter elements.
Now tell us whether a sundial always tells the correct time.
This depends on what you mean by correct time. Compared with a clock that runs uniformly, the sundial is slow from December 25th to April 15th, and from June 14th to September 1st. It is fast the rest of the year. Making this correction to your sundial gives the mean solar time for your particular longitude, but this is still not the same as standard time unless you happen to be right on the central meridian of your time zone.
Along that same line, why is it that the beginning of spring, summer, and so forth do not come each year on the same day?
In the time it takes our planet to go once around the sun, the Earth turns on its axis about 365 and a quarter times. That is, there are 365 and a quarter days in the year. Generally, therefore, the equinoxes, marking the beginning of spring and of autumn, like the solstices, which occur at the beginning of summer and of winter, are about a quarter of a day later each year. In 1948, for example, the spring equinox was on March 20th at 11:57 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. In 1949, on the same date, at 5:49 p.m. In 1950, at 11:36 p.m. And in 1951, on the 21st, at 5:26 a.m. In 1952, it would have been some 6 hours later on the 21st, had it not been a leap year. The extra day at the end of February moved the equinox back to March 20th at 11:14 a.m. Similarly, the summer solstice oscillates back and forth between June 21st and 22nd. The fall equinox between September 22nd and 23rd, and the winter solstice between December 21st and 22nd. In 1952, these all occur on the earlier dates.
Tup, you've probably noticed this. Why do so many worms sometimes appear on the ground after a rain?
This is probably because their tunnels are flooded and they come up for air. An earthworm will survive for some time in water, but needs air for a supply of oxygen. They will eventually drown in soil completely saturated with water.
Let's talk about water on a much larger and more active scale. How far over can a ship list and still right itself?
Ships are generally designed so that they will right themselves with a list or tilt of somewhat less than 90 degrees. And there are cases on record where they have listed even more than 90 degrees and recovered. Of course, the ability of a ship to right herself from such extremes depends on her retaining all her designed buoyancy. And this would be destroyed if she took on water through the stacks or other openings while she was listed.
Here's a letter from a listener who wants to know how she can prevent film from forming on glassware in her dishwasher.
The greatest help in preventing such film comes from rinsing the dishes before they are placed in the dishwasher and in using softened water if you live in a district where the normal water is hard. With such hard water, milk and other dairy products are especially bad in building up deposits on glassware. Thus, it helps considerably if glassware that contained milk, butter, and so forth is first washed by hand. With hard water, there are certain chemical products which can be added to counteract its effect, and while these help, they are not as effective as use of a water softener.
A listener in Texas wants to know where helium comes from and why there's so much of it in his home state.
All the helium on the Earth has been formed by the radioactive decay of uranium and thorium. These elements change into others with emission of alpha particles, which are nuclei of helium atoms. The helium found in Texas probably migrated there through porous rocks from the places where it was produced. It happens that at this location, the nature of the underground rocks is such as to retain the helium.
This next question really intrigues me. Our listener writes, I understand that the diameter of the Earth is about 26 miles greater at the equator than from pole to pole. Does this mean that a long river like the Mississippi, flowing from north to south, actually runs uphill, since its mouth is farther from the center of the Earth than its source?
Yes, it does. The radius of the Earth increases about 13 miles from pole to equator, an average increase of about a mile for every 480 miles you travel to the south. The delta of the Mississippi River is about 1,200 miles south of its source, which suggests that its mouth would be about 2.5 miles higher, measured from the center of the Earth, than its origin. Actually, the difference is not quite so much, since the source is at an altitude of about 1,670 feet. The equatorial bulge of the Earth is a result of centrifugal force caused by the Earth's rotation, and this same force makes the water of such a river flow away from the center of our planet.
Perhaps this letter was written just before our listener left on a safari. He wants to know if it is possible to make ice in a desert region where the temperature never falls below 60 degrees and where there is no mechanical refrigerating equipment.
Water evaporates very easily in the extremely dry air of the desert, and this cools the remaining water. In addition, if it is exposed at night, heat from the water may be radiated into the clear night sky, and still more heat lost. If the water is cooled by these two processes more rapidly than it gains heat from the surrounding air, the water that remains may eventually reach the freezing point. This process may be aided if a large area of water is exposed to the sky so as to increase the radiation of heat, and if the bottom and sides of the container are well insulated.
I'll have to try that sometime. Right now, can you tell us, what is peat and how is it formed?
Peat is a product of decayed vegetation found in bogs in many parts of the world. Some of the largest deposits are in Russia, Canada, Finland, and Sweden. In some of these countries, it is cut and dried and used as fuel. Peat originates with aquatic plants, such as reeds, rushes, mosses, and sedges. As they decompose, partly by oxidation from the moist air, and partly by the action of bacteria, yeasts, molds, and fungi, they become waterlogged, and the mass settles to the bottom of the pool. Thus, a considerable thickness, as much as 20 to 25 feet, may be built up.
Our final query is from a listener who wants to know if the regular use of softened water is likely to be harmful to the teeth or bones because of the removal of calcium.
No. While calcium is essential to a balanced diet, we get very small amounts at best from the water. It is present in most fruits and vegetables, and milk products are excellent sources of this element. In many places, the water is naturally soft and contains little or no calcium. Even in these regions, calcium deficiency is no problem as long as people have a normal, varied diet.
Right now, we're going to let our listeners' programmed diet become a little more varied, Tup. It's time for us to end this visit. I don't want to leave, of course, without reminding our listeners that copies of Dr. Dove's paper on insecticides are available to all who will write Excursions in Science in care of this station, asking for Science Paper 566. Use that same address when sending along questions for us to answer. Now, this is Bill Carpenter
and Howard Tupper
saying goodbye until the next transcribed Excursions in Science. Do you know how long any particular day lasts? Do you know how far away lightning can be seen? Do you know why squaring the circle is impossible? Or why leaves turn red and brown in the fall? These are some of the questions we'll be answering as we present transcribed Excursions in Science. Your science reporter, Howard Tupper, has been talking to Dr. James Stokely. Dr. Stokely is now with the General Electric Research Laboratory, but he was formerly director of the Fells Planetarium in Philadelphia and the Buell Planetarium in Pittsburgh.
Dr. Stokely wanted to tell me about the day and the dateline which separates days from each other.
Maybe this will give me some better understanding of news items I hear on the radio about what has already happened tomorrow.
Well, obviously, Bill, it's tomorrow only in terms of the time you observe locally. Dr. Stokely explained, first of all, that all of our time is based on the turning of the Earth from west to east,
which takes the equivalent of one of our 24-hour days. Actually, of course, it looks to us as if the sun were doing the moving and we were standing still.
That's right, Bill. And if we just remember that it is an illusion, that fiction of the sun's movement can be a very useful device for explaining the passage of time.
Yes, that makes it quite simple. Wherever the sun is directly south, that is on the meridian, it's noon.
Well, not quite, Bill. It would be that way if we all observed true local time. But it would be rather confusing to have odd minutes separating one place from a nearby one. It's a lot more orderly to keep most of our time observances a matter of one-hour steps.
And to do that, we've divided the entire surface of the Earth from west to east into 24 equal parts, haven't we?
Yes, time zones are spaced just 15 degrees of longitude apart. As Dr. Stokely pointed out, when the sun is on the meridian, which would make it noon in the eastern section of the United States, it has not yet reached the corresponding meridian at Chicago. Won't for another hour. Therefore, it is only 11 in the morning there. With the sun still farther east of the meridian at Denver, it is easy to see why, at that moment, it is only 10 in the morning in that location.
Well, in other words, as you kept traveling from east to west, you would have to set your watch back while you traveled until you had completely gone around the Earth and had set it back a full 24 hours.
That's right. But remember what I said about doing it in one-hour steps. Dr. Stokely pointed out that as the new day progresses around the world, it becomes Monday all at once from Maine to Michigan, and an hour later does the same from Kentucky to Texas.
In that case, the sundials wouldn't be absolutely correct in many places in the world.
Well, not for very long, anyway. But Dr. Stokely told me that there are some exceptions to the 24 major steps.
Don't they add confusion to something that's already complicated?
No. He said that on an isolated island in the Pacific, for example, there would be little advantage in using the time of the central meridian of the zone the island happens to lie in. I'll tell you some more about that in just a moment. But first, I'd like to explain the international date line we use.
Why do we use that anyway? It has always seemed to me such an arbitrary and artificial device.
You're entitled to your opinions, Bill, but we'd be in an awful fix if there were no date line somewhere.
Why?
Well, suppose you did go around the world from east to west, turning your watch back 24 times. How would your watch compare with that of someone else who just stayed in the original location?
The times would be identical.
Numerically, that's right. But since you had set your watch back 24 hours, you would find yourself a full day behind anyone who had stayed at home.
Which means that we have to have some line of demarcation.
Exactly. At some stage of that westerly trip, your calendar must be set ahead. The place chosen is the international date line, which follows approximately the meridian of 180 degrees longitude. West of this line, it is always the day after the one being marked to the east.
Why do you say the date line follows approximately the meridian of 180 degrees longitude? Aren't they identical?
No. The date line has two major kinks in it. Dr. Stokely told me that this was done to prevent complications which would arise if one group of islands, right on the meridian and under the same political administration, had two different days in different parts of their territory.
Let's see how that would work now. Under ideal conditions, with the date line running right along the meridian, it would be 7 hours slower than Eastern Standard Time to the east of the date line, and 17 hours faster than Eastern Standard Time to the west of the date line.
But in practice, the Tonga Islands, for example, observe time which is 17 hours, 19 minutes, and 12 seconds ahead of Eastern Standard Time. And Dr. Stokely told me that, according to the best available information, a Soviet possession, Wrangel Island, arbitrarily uses time which is 18 hours ahead of New York. Of course, there are some similarly peculiar examples of slow time to the east of the dateline.
Well, a day is still 24 hours, isn't it?
I'll have to shatter that notion too, Bill. It's certainly 24 hours long in any single location.
Oh, I see what you're getting at. It would take 24 hours for the beginning of any particular day to encircle the globe, and then another 24 hours to run through that particular day as the next day replaced it. In that sense, a day will last somewhere in the world for 48 hours.
That still does not allow for the special cases of time which is slower or faster than we would normally expect. At Wrangel Island, with its equivalent of a permanent daylight saving time, the day starts an hour earlier than elsewhere to the west of the dateline. Dr. Stokely said the slowest time used was at Niue Island and Savage Island. That time is 6 hours and 20 minutes behind the eastern United States. By the time the day was officially completed at Niue and Savage, it would have been in existence 48 hours and 20 minutes, counting from the time it began at Wrangel.
It's going to take me a day or so to get all that through my head, Tup. And it might be helpful if I have some of those oversized days at my disposal. I do want to thank you for this information which you have relayed from Dr. James Stokely of the General Electric Research Laboratory. Listeners who would like copies of Dr. Stokely's paper on the day and the dateline need only write to Excursions in Science in care of this station, asking for Science Paper 567. If there are any scientific questions or problems which our listeners would like to send along, these too should be addressed to Excursions in Science in care of this station. Every question will be referred to the General Electric Research Laboratory or some other authoritative organization, and every question will be answered by mail. Questions with general interest will be used on future broadcasts. First of all, a listener writes that he supposes that big fish in the sea eat little fish, but he wonders what the little fish eat to keep them alive.
For both big and little fish in the oceans, the staple food is what is called plankton. This includes a great variety of plants and animals with little or no powers of movement of their own, which are carried about by tides and currents. The name comes from a Greek word meaning wandering. In contrast, animals such as whales and fish which are able to swim and thus are more or less independent of tides and currents are called nekton. This is derived from another Greek word meaning swimming.
Out of the old mailbag comes the next question, asking, how far away can lightning be seen?
It is hard to give any definite figures, as visibility would be limited by the curvature of the Earth and the type of terrain over which one observes. In general, 15 miles would probably be the limit for strokes from clouds to the ground. So-called heat lightning, which consists of distant strokes between clouds, might be visible up to 20 miles or more.
Let's switch from distance to time. How many ordinary years are there in a light year?
You haven't switched at all, Bill. The year is a measure of time, all right, but the light year is one of length, like the mile. Light travels about 186,000 miles per second. In a year, it will go about 5,880,000,000 miles, and this is one light year. Sirius, the nearest bright nighttime star in the northern sky, is more than 8.5 light years away, while the most distant objects observed by the new 200-inch telescope are about 1,000,000,000 light years distant.
Now, can you tell us what is meant by squaring the circle, and why is it impossible?
This was a famous problem of the ancient Greeks. It was to draw a square having the same area as a given circle, using nothing beside the pencil but a compass and an unmarked straight edge. Though never solved, it was not until 1882 that it was proved impossible. The proof involves very advanced mathematical analysis and the fact that pi, the ratio between the diameter of a circle and its circumference, is what mathematicians call a transcendental number.
You have an argument to settle, Tom. Two sportsmen are in disagreement over whether a rifle bullet will rise above the line of bore after it has been shot from the gun.
In general, the bullet would drop below the line of the barrel. Possibly, with a very strong vertical wind, the bullet might rise slightly before it drops, but this would be very unlikely. It is also conceivable that some irregularities in the rifling might cause the bullet to spin in such a way that its path would deviate from normal by somewhat the same mechanism as that which makes a baseball curve. However, I doubt whether this would be enough to raise it appreciably above the line of the bore.
A listener asks you to explain ice quakes. Is there such a thing?
There certainly is. Ice quakes or frost quakes occur rather frequently. They are due to the freezing of the ground to a considerable depth and to the sudden thawing of the ground as the result of warm weather, especially when there is little or no snow on the ground. However, there is not as much known about ice quakes as we might wish. We do know that they occur and that they are believed to have been recorded on seismographs. One such frost shock or frost quake, for example, occurred in New England on January 7th, 1925, about 8 o'clock in the morning.
That certainly is pinpointing the phenomenon. Another member of our audience wants some equally accurate information on mammoths. He's especially interested in finding out whether the mammoth lived through the glacial period.
The mammoth is usually described as a rather hardy animal with a heavy covering of hair, capable of roaming over snowfields and glaciers. We know that the mammoth and his first cousin, the mastodon, survived the glacial period. We know that there were mammoths alive when cavemen lived in Central Europe. Since these cavemen made pictures of the mammoth, used his tusks as implements, then probably used the animal as food. Not so much is known of the American mastodon, but we do know that this animal survived the cold glacial period. Probably men were responsible for the extinction of both mammoth and mastodon.
Here's a question that many people ask. Why do leaves get red and brown in the fall?
This is due partly to chemical changes in the chlorophyll, green coloring matter of the leaves, which cause it to decompose. We are then able to see red and yellow substances, such as keratin and xanthophyll, which have been there all along, but were masked by the green coloration. Also, there are more complicated changes in which red, blue, and purple pigments, called anthocyanins, are formed. These are similar to the coloring matter in flowers and fruits.
Here's a final question. Do the planets Venus and Mercury ever come in front of the Sun?
Yes, they do, though a transit, as this phenomenon is called, is quite rare, particularly for Venus. Both Mercury and Venus are nearer the Sun than the Earth, but when they are in the same direction as the Earth from the Sun, they are generally above or below the Sun as we see them. Occasionally, however, they do come right in front of the Sun and may then be seen as a small black spot on the solar disk. The last transit of Venus occurred on December 6, 1882, and the next will be on June 7, 2004. The last transit of Mercury, however, was on November 12, 1940. There will be another on November 13, 1953, followed by another on May 5, 1957. They always occur in May or November, with the latter month the more frequent. There are 9 November transits of Mercury during the 20th century, and only 3 in May.
From transits to exits...
I wasn't talking about exits.
You'd better be thinking about one. Ours. Before we leave, I want to remind all our listeners that copies of Dr. Stokely's paper, On the Day and the Dateline, are available to all who will write to Excursions in Science, in care of this station, asking for Science Paper 567. Send your scientific questions along to that same address, and we'll see that they're answered. Now, this is Bill Carpenter
and Howard Tupper
saying goodbye until the next transcribed Excursions in Science.